can still hear myself, but
you've got us too then. Oh,
disappeared. There I am.
There you
there
are.
There you go. All right.
Okay. Here I am.
All right. So jumping back to it, Hadiya, introduce yourself to our crowd here today.
Okay. My name is Hadiya Nuriddin, and I've been in training for about, I'm going to say about 20 years now. I started with instructor-led training, like a lot of us do. And actually, as I alluded to, tech support, I actually started my career in technical support. And I had an English degree, but it was the 90s. And the qualifications were having a head, having a voice, and having a hands. And that was enough to get you into tech support. They said, if we can learn it, you can learn it. So I did that. And it's a burnout job. You know, it's in the 90s. It was nice because it was kind of like the NBA draft. You know, you could quit a job, get 10 grand more, you know, over and over again. So, but I rode that way for a while. And then the bubble kind of burst anyway. So then I went on to training, and much more glamorous. And luckily, the job I got, we had to do everything from, Hadiya, here's a project, where your evaluation. So I didn't know there were all these different professions within training. I thought you did it all. So that was nice. It gave me a chance to figure out what I wanted to do. And then when I found out about authoring tools and all of that, I started to branch off into that. I mean, I didn't have much of a choice. You know, again, we do everything, you know, so that's a magical skill, number 625 I had to adopt. So I started doing that. And then at some point, I just became unmanageable and went on my own. Yeah, about 10 years ago, this is my 10th anniversary freelancing. So, yeah, that's the gig. Cool. That's my story.
And so many pieces of what you're describing there, I'm sure have resonance for the folks in our group. You know, how many folks in our industry come in sideways, right? Where it's not like we went to school to be trainers or whatever, but we, you know, had other skills and that kind of led us into this place. Plus the sense of, oh, we do everything. Yeah. Which is one of the coolest parts of the job, right? You get to experience so many things. You get to, most of us have such an innate curiosity anyway, that something new, ooh, that's cool. So there's a, you know, but it is also a roller coaster. That is for sure.
I mean, sometimes I think it's a little exploiting our intellectual curiosity that they get us to do 20 jobs in one and pay us one salary. You know, I feel like it's like, when did I become a green screen actress? You know, I'm just trying to help people learn. That's it. I don't understand that. And a lot of people say, should I learn all these things? I'm like, well, you know, anytime I got laid off, I never was invited to the lunchroom to have a authoring two off where we battled and two people entered and one person exited. It didn't work that way. It's like, let's see, what department are you in? How much do you make? Protect the class. I mean, that was like, okay, you're in or out. They didn't know whether or not I knew what I was doing. And that's one of the things is that they don't know exactly what we do, which is good and bad. But it's fun.
Mm-hmm. And you noted that one of your first schooling, your first post-secondary schooling was an English degree. Mm-hmm. And also English degree here.
Yeah.
And that for me, that led into writing initially in journalism, which then led into writing instructional design here at dominKnow, where I've been ever since. But so that tells me though, that, you know, you've always had a lifelong interest in story, obviously then.
Right. Mean,
the reason I think most people get into English degrees is because we really, really like to read, and we're either going to think of ourselves as writing, or I don't know. Is there any other reason to do an English degree, right? Other than
avoiding math. Avoiding the math requirement.
Exactly.
That's how you do it. Yeah, I actually entered as a journalism major.
Oh, okay.
And then when I realized you had to engage with people, you know, what was funny was that I thought I changed my major after my first journalism class because I said, you know what, I can't feign interest. Like, if it's not a topic I'm not interested in, I can't pretend to be interested in it. And here I am as an instructional designer going, so tell me about that process. That's so interesting. Really? That widget loses money? Tell me more. You know, that is my life. So, like, I didn't have much wisdom at 19 as I thought I did.
If only we had a little bit of a crystal ball, eh?
Yeah. I know, but I have to say, you know, for years I kicked myself for getting that English degree. I'm like, why did I do that? And I'm like, oh my God, thank God. I mean, even in tech support, to be able to communicate with people and listen to them and now just sort of weave all this together as a facilitator and to be able to take in information and spit out that information and connect ideas. Hey, that's English major central right there. I got that English degree.
So at what point, swinging back to storytelling, at what point did you sort of discover or come to, or did the light bulb go on that training, you know, isn't necessarily just here's info, put it in your brain and now, you know, do it. But storytelling becomes a tool in that. Let's you know, do you have any recollections of any specific kind of projects or things that brought you to that next step of thinking about storytelling?
I was guest speaking in a class the other day and someone asked me that question. And I have always told the story that I got a master's degree in writing to be a world famous novelist. Mm-hmm. Turns out there's no ads in the paper for that job. So I went back to instructional design. And that's when I saw that connection between narratives and instructional design. But actually, as I reflected on it, I realized that's not entirely true. Actually, story came first. I mean, it was first. I mean, I have always been a lifelong love of films and books and writing and all of that stuff way before I knew there was a such thing as instructional design. So I think if I would get really specific, I have this lost era in my life, as I call it, in my early 30s, where all I did was play The Sims. That was it. Straight up addicted to The Sims. And I was in tech support at this time, but some of that bled over into my training career. And that's all I did. So I used to kick myself for that, but it came back to me because early in my instructional design career, very early, I was told to teach this performance management course. And it became obvious to me that this course didn't really exist. What it was someone had copied passages from the employee manual and pasted it on slides. And I was supposed to go in there and read this to them. Now, I didn't know a lot about training at that point, but I knew that that wasn't happening. I wasn't going to go in there and read a bunch of policies. So I sort of got up the courage and asked my boss, can I design a class out of this, right? And he said, okay, go ahead. You got 2 weeks. So I really based the class on The Sims. I used characters from The Sims. I basically brought The Sims to work. And the idea of building this world and having characters play different roles and engage with people, with each other in all these different ways and build generations and all that, that was all in my head as I was putting this class together. So, you know, each table had a different character. I would throw them these wild cards so that then, even though you have a same character, your character went on different. It was overly complicated in retrospect. And this wasn't e-learning. I mean, this was like workbooks and, you know, all these different things. It was way too much. But what was incredible about it to me was that the way people latched onto these characters and were building backstories for them that wasn't a part of the training that I never said. They were digging into their own past and they recognized what this character was like, and they were attributing all these qualities to them from people that they knew that was just like that. And I was like, this is interesting that they are so engaged. And I didn't know anything about story at the time. I didn't know that this was useful. I just wanted to bring the Sims to work. And that's when everything sort of clicked in some way that, if I get people emotionally invested in these characters and make them real, then maybe they'll be more engaged in the class, you know? Mm. And so really ever since then, and this just sort of came to me a few weeks ago, that it was really after that point that everything I built, I try to either put a narrative arc in there, because there's always a narrative arc in the course, in my mind, because there's always a, this is where they are, this is where you want them to be. So even if I'm facilitating the course I didn't design, I start looking for that narrative arc that hold, that everything is connected to, that hinges together. And of course I'm designing, I create the arc and have those events connect on to that.
So maybe let's jump in and hit, go a little deep onto that phrase, just in case anybody doesn't know what a narrative arc is. Mm-hmm. Maybe just kind of explain that a little bit.
Well, often there's different interpretations of it, but it really is the, this is where the people are. They go through some things and they end up on the other side. The question is, the go through some things is how you're going to push them, you know, to the other side, and what obstacles get in the way that they encounter, and how they overcome those obstacles. And that's one thing I think that people struggle with story, is that it's not the being here, it's the getting here. And it's, many people will tell you stories and they just start at the end. You know, I just walked in there and I did all these great things. And, you know, it's like, who is this helping? You know, and one thing I say that is, storytelling is about you, but not for you, right? So if you're telling your personal story, it is about you. A lot of storytelling instructors will say it's not about you, but it is. I mean, you need to honor that vulnerability and authenticity that it takes to get up there and tell your story, but you have to tell it in service for someone else. What can I emphasize? What points can I pull out that will actually help other people on their journey? But many times people are telling stories for themselves. Mm-hmm. When I was in tech support, this was, again, during the 90s, where you had the guys with a pager on each hip, and they would tell all these heroic stories about how they drove in the middle of the night to reboot a server. You know, it's like, that's a great story. You're awesome. But that's not helping me figure out IP addresses, you know, at all. So
Skylar has tossed a question or a comment into the chat, which I think gives us a chance to talk a little bit about, you know, what role or what benefits, I guess, storytelling can play. He notes, we aren't purely logical beings. Emotions play a part in our existence, including learning. The more emotions can be experienced, the richer the experience will be, and increased likelihood of applying it. And that certainly, it speaks to like a difference with when storytelling, as opposed to simply presentation, you know, of information, is that, you know, it is hopefully trying to either trigger some emotions or lock in, you know, the information that way. Is that the chief benefit you feel of storytelling, or are there other pieces of the equation that storytelling brings?
I think that's a big part of it. My thinking has evolved a little bit on the emotion part, because emotions are the triggers. That's how you recognize yourself based on how you feel, right? Because you may not have experienced this exact same thing, But at its core, there is something that could trigger you as far as I may have not been in that situation, but I felt helpless before. I felt lost before. I felt vulnerable before. And it's up to you as the storyteller, because the story doesn't do that by magic. And that's one thing I want to stress too. You know, a lot of people talk about just add a story, put it in a story. No, you have to do that. Story is just a carrier. It's just the carrier itself. It's just a framework in which you can put things in. So you have to be the one to sort of pull those out and emphasize those points. But at the same time, sometimes I struggle with the idea that you owe the world your emotions or that the subject matter experts owes the world this sort of deeper truth. I tend to lean on the side of authenticity. You don't owe the world, you know, your emotions, but you do owe them your authenticity. You do owe them the truth. I always say there's a difference between what is true and what is the truth. You know, earlier when I was telling my sort of origin story about how I was in tech support and I ended up instructional design, that's true. But the truth is I spent 2 years being cursed out on the phone every day. And it was a nightmare. And I didn't go to training going, gee, training's so cool. I want to do that. It was like, I need a way out of this because I'm going to lose my mind. And I think what's so nice about that period, of course, is that now there's nothing on a training evaluation that's so horrible that someone didn't say to my face back in 1998, you know, because I've got that thick skin because of that, right? There's that truth of how what I got from each of those jobs that makes the difference instead of just stating all of those facts. And so, you know, again, you don't necessarily have to, doesn't have to. And I think that's why some people stray from storytelling is that they don't like to hear about, I mean, emotions, and we all approach emotions different ways. Some people shut down at the idea of emotion. Mm-hmm. So we can't just assume that everyone's like, oh, I can feel now. So I totally get this. That's not necessarily true. Some people shut down, you know, because of that. So it's about you being able to balance what's true with the truth and you understanding intellectually how emotion works in your story and how useful it is to bring up certain points and trigger certain things. Mm-hmm. So, you know.
Yeah. And in the official chat forum, Mr. J is actually bringing up something that I think can lead us into another aspect of our conversation today. I find telling a story helpful when relating the what's in it for me and any cautionary points. It works well live because you know the audience. How do you identify the right story for an e-learning module that can be taken by multitudes of diverse folks with diverse experiences? Mm-hmm. And I mean, even how do you approach just even finding the stories in training content when, you know, you are not a SME, so you haven't had the experience of, you know, working in particularly a particular category of information. How do you go about finding and discovering, I guess, useful stories or stories that are, you know, appropriate to help in the way that we want them to help?
Well, I always say if you can't find the story, find the people. It's sort of like we're almost like documentary filmmakers, you know, in that we go in and we tell stories for people who can't tell their own. And we need to go in with empathy and listening and finding, again, I mentioned that core of the story. As a freelancer, I go from topic to topic to topic and company to company to company. And even when I was internal, I go from topic to topic to topic. I never supported just one topic ever in my career. And my job was always to find this sort of, again, this narrative stream throughout all of them is that this is where they are now. This is where we want them to be. What's stopping them from getting there? And of all the things that's stopping them, of which there is meaning, training is not having training is none of those. What is the solution and how can training support that solution? So this is perfect world stuff. In a perfect world, you go in and they say, this is where people are now. We want them to be here. We know that managers aren't communicating with them because managers aren't sure what to tell them. So you can train our managers on these three things, but that doesn't happen, right? Them even being able to articulate where people are, especially for a diverse group. Like I never designed for one audience either, right? So it's a bunch of different topics and one class is going to a million people. I use ethics as an example. In a lot of ethics training, if you have a salesperson, you may want to use a scenario that if you take someone out to lunch, depending on the policy, you know, you don't want them to pay because it looks like a pay for play type of situation. So you may think you want to use that scenario, but not everyone is in that situation. They're like, he can pay for lunch. Yeah, I work in IT. What do I care? Trying to find a scenario that speaks to everyone can be an issue. But that's why it's your job to be able to cut through, you know, what the company is trying to get, what performance they're trying to see, and be able to build a common scenario out of that. You can also branch it within an inch of its life as well. But trying to find what that core is that you are in a situation where your ethics could be compromised. It's not necessarily whether it's lunch, whether it's going through someone else's mail, you are in a situation where your ethics are compromised. So you can build a scenario, but when you start breaking it down, that's the question. Whether or not you are in that situation is not necessarily important. What matters is how I break it down and the subsequent screens that says, imagine you're in a situation right now where your ethics could be compromised. What do you do? What decision that you make? And that's with you pulling away from all the details of the story and looking sort of deeper at the people and what they're experiencing and what they're going through. So when it comes to getting the story, when I sit people down, subject matter experts, they, you know, always want to, well, they want to tell you what's true, right? They want to tell you all these. And I usually sort of just break away from all that and just always say, let's talk about Bob. Let's talk about him and what he's doing. Of course, it's someone I just made up. It's just a name that I gave him. But I want to talk about why he's not doing what you think he should be doing. What are the obstacles in the way? And we just keep, you know, talking and working with that. I have this tool that I use called the Story Spine. And I talk about it on my workshops and all that. And you can Google it. It's everywhere. It's an improvisation tool. And it's a bunch of prompts that start with setting the scene. And then there's one that says, but one day, which is the inciting incident for all you English teachers out there. It's that thing that changes everything. And of course, Joseph Campbell, which someone mentioned in the chat, the hero's journey is that crossing the threshold where you will never return the same. Right. So I use that as a template. And I go through and I don't say, we're going to fill this out together. I just go and answer, you know, have them answer all the questions with me as we walk through it. And that keeps them on this narrative arc, like that keeps the story flowing. And because I know I'm one of those people who tell a story of like, did you see that blue dress I was wearing? Wait, did I tell you about it? When did I see you last? When you're like, just tell me about the blue dress. Deal with all of this. And so what's nice about the story spine is that it keeps you focused, right? You have that inciting incident, and then you have all of these sort of because of that statements that have to have happened as a direct result of the inciting incident and the step that came before it. So when people start going on tangents, you go, you know, no. What happened immediately after Bob cursed that customer out? Like what happened immediately after that? What did Bob do? What happened? Not what you did. Let's stay centered in Bob's story, right? And they may go, well, I want something like, just trust me. Let's go. And then we can, you know, tell it from different points of view. But what I end up having is all of these completed templates of the story spine that I can use as I'm building out the e-learning and mix and match, pick and choose. But at least I have the people's story.
Mm-hmm. The practitioner in me loves that as a tool. But I got to tell you, I'm afraid that my family will find out about that and use it to keep me on track when I'm starting to tell a story. Because I'm all over the map. Dad's going to tell a story now. Yeah, let's.
Yeah. One thing I want to emphasize too about stories is kind of stories that we use in training is that they're always. There's different types of stories, but stories of transformation are the stories that you want to focus on. It's hard to believe that someone can tell a story where nothing happens, but we've heard them. And it's just, at that point, it's an anecdote, right? And you know, I mean, I'm not that much of a purist. If you call it a story, you can call it a story. But for our purposes in learning and development, we're always interested in transformation. And what was the journey to get where they need to be? How did they overcome obstacles? And when it comes to e-learning, you know, you have to don't forget to include the learner. So you don't necessarily blurt out what those obstacles are. You sort of take them on the path, right? So you present that, if you look at the story spine, you sort of present that this is where we are now. And then as you're building the early, you start asking questions about what could happen next. This is the setup. What do you think could happen, you know, based on this, right? And so you go a different path that way. You sort of build them into the spine after the fact so they can see all the different options and other paths that people can take. And it sort of goes from there, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Do you ever find that it's difficult to sell the idea of using a story in e-learning or in training when you're designing it to your clients and folks? Why don't, because I've heard from people several times say, why can't you just put the content in there? If you put all that extra stuff in there, it's going to take them a lot more time to go through it. They just want the information. And I kind of think back to myself, well, maybe some just want the information, but others maybe want to go a little bit deeper.
You know, we don't always care about Todd's journey. You know, I mean, it's just give us the information that we need. And, you know, I understand that. You know, first of all, the class is always a story, right? There's always, they can pretend like it's not there. They cannot. So whether or not I'm in that situation or not, I'm always thinking in that narrative, even if I don't mention a character. You know, I definitely look at it as this journey between, you know, even software, you know, I use Excel as an example. No one wants to learn how to use Excel. No one wants to learn how to do that ever. But when we used to teach that back in the 2000s and maybe even today, we taught it was started with the file menu, went across and went down and no one cared. Mm-hmm. What people want to know how to do is manage a budget. What they want to know how to do is create a planning document. And how, if I use Excel to do that, so be it. It's already a story, right? It's already there. So you can pretend like it's not, but it's already there. You don't have to necessarily
name it. Everything's a story.
Right? I mean, that's the flow. If you're teaching it in a way that, the learner can relate to is if this is a usable way. So one thing that I do, let's see if I have, I don't think my little sign will fit in here, but one thing that I've been doing is changing the language a little bit. And I call it a high fidelity reimagining of a lived experience, right? That way, we don't have to talk about stories if you don't want to, but I do have to talk about lived experiences. Like you can call it whatever you want, but if we want people to feel this, if we want people to recognize themselves in this. And I think that's the most important thing, more than, you know, I can sort of feel the heartbeat of the story. It's more, not that I went through training, but I lived that. I've done that before because I did it in the training. We can only do that if we tell the truth. We can only do that if talk about what this job is like and what people are experiencing. And a story is a carrier for that. It's a, you know, so I think of story, again, just as a carrier. You know, my goal is not to tell a story. My goal is to tell the truth. My goal is to get that from you. And part of that truth is whatever conflicts are happening with, you know, whatever tool is happening, any internal conflicts this is driving. That's all the truth. And the story is the carrier that I can use to convey that.
Mm-hmm. It's almost like we call them simulations, but simulations are always just stories too, right? It's just like you're going through an experience multiple times, because in a lot of jobs, the more you go through a particular experience, that's how you gain experience. And you have a tendency, like in sales, for example, you're going through the same process with a new person multiple times. And mm-hmm. so the sooner you can go through that process, even if it's just sort of in a simulated environment or a simulated training session, mm-hmm. the more times you can go through it, the more you experience it, the more you can try out new things and see how they work. And you can just learn from those experiences. And it just seems natural that stories are just a part of that learning process.
Yeah. And it provides that safe environment as well. So yeah, they see themselves in a safe environment that they can repeat it, you know, over and over again. So that's definitely helpful if they
and
can.
If in the class,
but I think part of that
instructor too, right?
What was that?
I was just gonna say, if you're in a classroom, it doesn't have to be like simulation or e-learning. They can ask questions too and say, well, what if I said this or what if I said that? And you can say as an instructor, well, try. Here we go. Let's.
Well, that's how we always did it. You know, that's what we're trying to. I think what I'm trying to recreate in e-learning is that feeling of spontaneity of, you know, let's go deeper. Let's keep looking. Let's keep, you know, let's explore that. You know, that's not something that we can do, you know, in e-learning very often, and not in a way that feels very authentic. And so trying to find ways to recreate that spontaneity is always the challenge. And, you know, having, you know, different branches and different elements of the story is also helpful.
Yeah. Richard's asking in the Q&A panel, what are some of the most common roadblocks that you've encountered to creating a narrative?
Mm-hmm. You know, let's just be real. So much of what we create training for is just information. Mm-hmm. And, you know, you pick what sword you want to die on, you know, or what heel, I can't remember, something mm-hmm. to die on. You fight those battles, but, you know, they need to get the training out. So much is information. So if I am not able to get that beginning and end, if I'm not able to get the starting point and where they ended, I can't get it. Mm-hmm. Like I can't make it up. And why I'd like to say, well, then just make them a pamphlet and storm out dramatically with a boa that I flip around. I'm a freelancer, so I'm like, sure. I'm just telling you. I mean, I'm all about consequence management. Like, this is what could happen if we go this route, and that you will be wasting a lot of money. So, you know, that's fine. You know, I mean, I don't know what to tell you. But even internal, you know, I have more leverage as a consultant sometimes rather than internal, because as a consultant, I'm like, hey, you invited me here. I didn't break into your house and tell you that compliance training must happen. I didn't whisper that in your ear when you slept. You invited me here, you know. So they are more often, you know, likely to listen to me a little bit more. But I was internal. It was a harder battle to fight. Which is even a lot of my ex people I worked for became my clients, And I kind of feel like that was weird because you would have let me do that when I was in the
external. Isn't that the weirdest thing? I've experienced that too. It's like when you're the external person, you're the same person, but you're external. All of a sudden you got smarter when you're external. As soon as you're internal, you're not as smart. And we're going to go get a consultant. You're like, no, wait a minute. Why did you hire me then?
One time the president, because I was such a troublemaker back then, but the president of the company at some big meeting said, this initiative is so important. We're going to get some real training, not internal stuff. And of course I ran back and told everybody. I can't believe he said that. Such a troublemaker. But, you know, I was young. I was like 37.
Back in our youth, right? Oh, you were such fools.
Youth is wasted on that. Yeah.
No kidding. I'm just going to scroll back up and see if there were any other questions that people were dropping into the chat. There's been lots of great comments. Kim has a five-step sort of, a numbered five sequence of a common story structure she uses. Mm-hmm. Ordinary world, current skill level, opportunity for growth, skill level needed, first challenge, practice new skill, number four, harder challenges, application of new skills at increasing difficulty, and five, lesson learned, new skill attained. And that's really cool. That one of the things I've also been thinking about is that the idea of what, of how elaborate, let's call it, or how big or engulfing, I guess, a story is can vary between different kinds of projects. Sometimes the story is fairly simple. People have to be able to do this, and it's but you don't need to necessarily build a lot of characters around it, etc., and mm-hmm. to wrap it, depending on the nature of mm-hmm. of the content. And what I'm seeing in Kim's is really there's a story structure, but it could be a simple. It could apply to more, let's call it less narrative type training that we often have to make as well.
There's a couple of different formats that I use. I mean, to me, there's the overarching story where you the whole class is enveloped in this story, and sometimes it's tough because you can't have things. You know, season one can't conflict season two. Like you're like, it gets, again, you're a humble instructional designer. You're not a screenwriter, you know, but you have to, once you walk through that door, you need to walk all the way through because that's what people are expecting. So that's one way of doing it. One way that I often find myself doing is I'll have one character who is our guide, you know, avatar that's weaving this all together. And this person is pulling on different scenarios throughout. One I had where she was the main character. She appeared throughout. She had a couple of cases on her own that she was working through. But she also would occasionally say, let's look in my case files. And these are some other situations that I had before. So that gave me a way to sort of do a three-layered story where her story had to stay consistent. Then you had these five students whose stories had to stay consistent. And, you know, it was about counselors who helped students that were studying abroad. And when I realized that we couldn't just have one person go through all these trauma. Right. I was like, he needs to come home. module two, he needs to just come home. So being able to have, you know, different students in these different stages of studying abroad made a big difference. But then also we got to dabble in other topics by her going into her case files and saying, read this scenario. This makes sense. Going to therapy.
So good. Oh man, stories. We love stories. We should probably put a lessons learned on the end of this story today.
go ahead. Nope, you go ahead.
Yeah, I guess one last thing that I've been saying a lot when it comes to what type of story, and this kind of helps me when I'm working with a SME, is I say for stories, think headlight, not spotlight. right? So this is not, you're not telling me just a story that's just about you. That's not, tell me a story that serves as a headlight so that other people can see and into the future. And so that's both about, you know, personal storytelling for yourself, but also when you're sitting down with a subject matter expert, when I'm trying to listen to a story, when I think, well, the story, how can we take this story that affects you and make it something that other people can learn from based on what you've been through? So, you know, think headlight, not spotlight.
I love that.
That's absolutely fabulous. That's a very cool phrasing. Love it. Probably a good time for us to bring ourselves to a wrap. Brent's got his finger on the music button there. Hadiya, don't forget to drop your contact info wherever people can find you or wherever you'd love to have them connect with you if they want to learn more or continue this conversation. There's the groove already. Thanks so much for joining us this week. It's been absolutely a pleasure to have you with us. And we'll have to bring you back again and continue talking or telling these stories a bit further and see where else we can go on these things. Thanks, as always, to our folks in the chat. Lots of great comments and things to catch up on in there. And thank you, everybody, for joining us here. We're going to dance on out of here. Have a great rest of your Wednesday if you're joining us live. Have a great rest of your whatever day it is if you're listening to us, say, on the recorded podcast.
Indeed. Thanks,
Hadiya. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you.
Good to see you. Everybody have a great week. Adios. Give me a good zoom there, Chris.